Despite the perks of holding government office, some of America's esteemed elected officials have covered themselves in far more debt than they have glory. From founding fathers to lowly congressmen, these U.S. politicians have had the misfortune of losing all of their money. Thomas Jefferson served the United States before it even became a country. He wrote the Declaration of Independence, was the second vice president in history, and then the third president. He commissioned the Lewis and Clark Expedition, doubled the nation's size with the Louisiana Purchase, and ended the pirate threat in the Mediterranean. It would be difficult to understate the importance of Jefferson to American history. So how did such an accomplished man end up as the country's most financially challenged founding father? It seems that he did the exact same thing millions of Americans do today. He spent more than he had. Jefferson lived far beyond his means, and according to the Thomas Jefferson Foundation, the former president may have lived his entire adult life in debt. In fairness, Jefferson did inherit a huge debt from his father-in-law early in his marriage. But the main reason seems to be that Jefferson was a world-class impulse buyer. The third U.S. president was known for spending amounts of money on building projects, furnishings, clothes, scientific instruments, and wine.
So they were rather heavy wines and overly sweet.
A truly American president, Jefferson just liked to buy more than he could afford. Like most American presidents of the time, Abraham Lincoln was a man of many talents. He was a lawyer, wrestler, state politician, and the first Republican president. Lincoln also ushered in the end of the Civil War, so it's safe to say that he's kind of a big deal. It wouldn't be strictly accurate to say Lincoln went broke, more like he continued in that state until achieving certain successes in politics. Born into poverty in that famous log cabin, his mother died when he was 9, and he literally worked barefoot in the fields alongside his father and sister. Lincoln's origins were the definition of humble. When he was 24 years old, Lincoln and a friend bought a general store in Illinois. Lincoln didn't have the money, signing a promissory note to the previous owners instead. Unfortunately, Lincoln and his friend were competing against a larger store in town. As a result, Lincoln's store did little to no business. When the deadline on his note came due, Lincoln couldn't pay it. As a result, all of his possessions were confiscated. To make matters worse, his business partner died, and died broke. Honest Abe assumed his half of the debt, and it took the future emancipator many years to pay it off in full. William McKinley was the 25th president and the first of the 20th century. He swiftly and successfully led the nation through the Spanish-American War, annexed the Republic of Hawaii as a new American territory, and officially backed the dollar with gold. McKinley was also the third American president to be assassinated, although he was a pretty popular president who won re-election in a landslide. Although his family did well enough to send him to a good college, McKinley wasn't born wealthy. He became wealthy with a busy legal career, which boosted his profile. McKinley's law career also made it easy for him to enter Congress, where he was very popular with the voters. Ironically, Congressman McKinley would earn half as much as he did when he was a practicing lawyer. Years earlier, McKinley had co-signed on a debt for a friend that got him into financial trouble after the friend went bankrupt. McKinley ended up in debt to the tune of $3 million in today's dollars. As a result, McKinley was forced to declare bankruptcy himself while serving as the governor of Ohio. However, says the University of Virginia's Miller Center, McKinley gained widespread public sympathy when his financial fortune suffered. As a result, McKinley won favor with Ohio's voters and was ultimately returned to the governor's office. George McGovern was an accomplished man. He was a U.S. Senator, U.S. Representative, World War II veteran, and historian. He flew bombing raids over Germany during World War II, earning the Distinguished Flying Cross for heroism, and in his very first year in the Senate, became the first congressman to criticize America's involvement in Vietnam.
Peace, not war.
As his 2012 obituary in the Christian Science Monitor summarized, McGovern was, quote, a war hero who fought for peace. Unfortunately, McGovern is best known as being on the receiving end of one of the worst U.S. election defeats in history, losing every state except Massachusetts to incumbent Richard Nixon in 1972. Of course, that's not all he would lose.
We will shed no tears because all of this effort, I am positive, will bear fruit for years to come.
After McGovern left politics, He bounced around the world giving lectures. He seemed to be finally settling down in the late 1980s, and in 1988, he went all in on a property in Stratford, Connecticut, writing later in the Wall Street Journal, "Hotels, inns, and restaurants have always held a special fascination for me." Regrettably, the former Democratic presidential hopeful didn't understand how private business worked and had to file for bankruptcy just a year and a half later. Years later, as he reminisced about his time as a businessman, McGovern commented that he would have been a better politician if he had gone broke first. In 1981, Tom McMillan founded the McMillan Communication Corporation, which manufactured beepers. It was the 1980s and pagers were everywhere. They were so ubiquitous that by the end of the decade, Sir Mix-a-Lot's classic track Beepers became the number two rap song on the Billboard charts. By 1992, however, McMillan was a congressman running for re-election, and his company was going bankrupt. In a classic case of the Streisand effect, the congressman changed the name of his company to the Pager Communication Corporation. The Baltimore Sun noticed, writing, "Several disgruntled investors have charged that the last-minute name change was designed to shield Mr. McMillan from the potential political embarrassment of being closely associated with a failing business." Sadly, McMillan lost his bid for re-election that year. The hits kept coming, though, as federal agents seized financial records from one of McMillan's bankrupt firms. In reporting the story, the Baltimore Sun noted, "Since 1992, McMillan has become involved in numerous business ventures, often in risky startup companies that have flopped or suffered other problems." Although no charges were filed, he did lose his position as chairman of President Bill Clinton's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports. One might think that a seat on the Financial Services Committee of the U.S. House of Representatives would require a member to not be in debt to the very banks they'll be regulating. However, that is not always the case, as was demonstrated by longtime Texas Democrat Ruben Hinojosa. Hinojosa sat on the committee when he filed for bankruptcy in 2010, after accruing nearly $3 million in debt. The Huffington Post reported on the congressman's financial troubles, writing, "Hinojosa attributed his bankruptcy to a loan he secured to rescue a slaughterhouse founded by Hinojosa's father and uncle after the company declared bankruptcy in 2008. Others were less kind in their speculations on the reasons for Hinojosa's financial ruins, including reckless spending on the congressman's part. In 2011, the Daily Caller published this report. In the 5 months since filing for bankruptcy, Texas Rep. Ruben Hinojosa has spent about $1,800 on clothes, $680 on cleaning service, and given his children a total of $540 in allowance. Furthermore, Hinojosa's political opponents had even more reason to be happy when it was revealed that Hinojosa was among several members of Congress who were forced to return gifts worth thousands of dollars. According to The Hill, the gifts were given to the Congress members on a trip that the government of Azerbaijan had sponsored. Harry Truman desegregated the military, helped rebuild Europe after World War II, and dropped the only nuclear weapons ever used in war. Not bad for a guy who became president after being vice president for less than 3 months. Truman was also perennially unlucky with money and would go on to have the less than flattering title of America's poorest president. The son of a farmer, Truman did not grow into wealth. At the age of 14, he began working at a drugstore. Truman also lived in hobo camps along the Missouri River so he could work at a railroad after school. After serving overseas during World War I, Truman opened a haberdashery with an army friend. However, Truman had to close the store within 3 years and was deep in debt as a result.
When you get to feeling too good about something you've done, watch out.
In recalling the experience, Truman had this to say, "It was a hard experience for me at the age of 38 to fail in a business venture in which I had spent considerable money and time." Then he became president and began earning $100,000 a year. But after leaving the White House, Truman's income dropped to poverty level until, according to Forbes, Truman earned just $14,000 in 1954. The former president quickly rebounded by taking writing and speaking gigs, and within 3 years, Truman was making over $100,000. In response to Truman's post-presidential money problems, modern presidents now have a full retirement package. Even though he was the general who won the Civil War, Ulysses S. Grant's tenure as president has not received the best reputation over the years. He may have defeated the Ku Klux Klan as president, but today, Grant's 2 terms are best remembered for the various financial scandals that consumed his administration. In fact, financial trouble defined much of Grant's life. After fighting in the Mexican War, Grant was stationed in what would become Washington State. It was there that the future president became involved in several investments that went bust. After resigning his commission in 1854, Grant began farming in Missouri on property his father-in-law set aside for him. The farm failed within a few years, and Grant was forced to accept working as a clerk in his father's store in Illinois before his time as a Civil War general and U.S. president. Once his presidency had ended, Grant, who by then was already the most famous man in America, was determined to make a fortune in investment banking. He lost it all quickly, however, and within 2 years was borrowing money from his son. Grant tried making money again, this time with help from his son, but was robbed by his son's business partner. After being diagnosed with cancer, Grant started writing his memoirs, as he saw no other way to provide for his family. He was almost swindled again until Mark Twain stepped in and offered the Civil War hero a fair publishing contract. Despite being born into a fairly wealthy family, President James Monroe, who has often been called the last founding father, didn't have the easiest upbringing. His parents both died when he was a teenager, forcing him to leave school at 16 to manage the family property and raise his younger brothers. Monroe entered politics as public sentiment against the British was at an all-time high. So when the Revolutionary War began, Monroe enlisted into the Continental Army. His legal and political career took off quickly, going from the Virginia House of Delegates to the U.S. Senate to the presidency. Being president didn't pay much then, and Monroe left the White House in debt. After his presidency, Monroe tried to pay off his debts. According to the Miller Center, one way Monroe tried doing this was by pressing the federal government for tens of thousands of dollars that were due to him from past services. Monroe also began writing books, including his autobiography. Monroe even tried selling his personal correspondence with Thomas Jefferson to the former president's family. Needless to say, Jefferson's family declined the offer. Finally, and after much prodding, Monroe was able to get Congress to pay him a portion of what he felt he was owed so he could settle his debts. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.